Hello, and welcome from me, Mike Scott, from Oxford in the UK, from Father Joe Simmons and Professor Catherine Temple in Georgetown University, Washington, D.C. This is the eighth event in this new series, which is following on from the Christian Literary Imagination series and our earlier series, Christian Shakespeare Question Mark, which is now available as a book, published by Vernon Press. All three series are part of Georgetown University's Humanities Initiative in association with Campion Hall, Oxford, and the Las Casas Institute for Social Justice at Blackfriars Hall, Oxford. In a moment, I will introduce today's speaker, Professor Estelle Thompson. Your participation is as important as ever, so please type in any questions you have from the start of our talk by using your Q&A button at the bottom of your screen. You can do this from the moment we begin the session. We will endeavor to answer your questions in discussion with Catherine and Joe and myself at the end of the event. Ensure that you use your Q&A button and not, please, your chat button. So, as to Estelle, I've known Estelle Thompson for many years. She is one of the UK's leading artists. She holds the prestigious chair of Professor of Painting at the world-famous Slade School of Art in London. She lives and works in London and in Barbados. But she grew up in a town called Walsall in the industrial Midlands. And would you believe it? That's the town in which I grew up and in which Maggie, my wife, grew up as well. Though we didn't know Estelle at the time. But there we are, come from Walsall. And I'm very proud of her for being from Walsall, because not many people of note even know about Walsall. So what has she done? She has created art all her life. She created art within an abstract tradition, an art which comes from a tradition that you'll know from Rothko or Bridget Riley or Frank Bowling or from her great friend Maurice Cockerill. And she is not out of place in that list of names. I've had the pleasure of working with her at De Montfort University and at Glyndŵr University. And I've also seen the kind of work that she's been doing in Barbados, where she and her husband, also an artist, Dennis Dekeres, have run an art gallery called the Brighton Storeroom, which sadly has recently closed, but we hope one day might be revitalized. I'm really looking forward, as many people are, to today's lecture. So over to you, Estelle Thompson.
Thanks, Mike. A little bit of my history revealed there that doesn't usually get revealed. So today I'm going to share my screen now, which has a PowerPoint for you of images of work that I'm going to talk about. So I will immediately do that, if you don't mind. So as you will have seen already, and many of you won't know my work, but I am principally a painter, and I've worked as an artist, curator, educator, and designer. And I have made many paintings, and you will see a very small section of the different types of paintings that I've made over a long period of time. But both central to that practice and to the design work in with regards to public buildings, it has almost always been colour, and the nature of colour is that colour is formed by light. And those are the principles that have driven and interested me in both areas and fields of research. So you will have seen that it explains that I am interested in colour, form, space. And unfortunately, by a slight error, it says colour, form, space, and geography to extend the history of abstraction, optics, and contemporary aesthetics. That's a little bit of an issue in that it should say the colour, form, space and geometry to extend the history of abstraction, optics and contemporary aesthetics. Something got lost in translation, but I rather like when these errors occur, because in fact landscape and nature and colour in nature and geography, essentially, also, as well as geometry, are very much in there. I want to start really about talking about this interest in how fundamental colour is to all aspects of our lives, colour in the world, and to my passionate desire to celebrate that in all that I make and do. I feel that its function, colour has a function which is all positive for humanity. And in fact, you know, the title of the talk refers to the nature of, you know, well-being and good spirit in relation to colour in all that we experience. So seeing and optics are very, very key. And this interaction between both a studio practice and an interest in research into colour and works in the public domain absolutely overlap. And so that's what I'm going to try and look at. But just as one little introduction, I would like to just remind you of what colour is. And colour is light. And I'm going to read this out to get it sort of precise for you. How we perceive the colour of an object is due to how much it absorbs or reflects portions of the colour spectrum coming from the sun's light. When light strikes any coloured object, the object will absorb only the wavelengths that exactly match its own atomic structure, and they reflect the rest, and that is what we see. When light strikes the eye, the wavelengths do so in different ways, influencing our perceptions. In the retina, they're converted into electrical impulses that pass the part of our brain governing our hormones and our endocrine system. So our bodies and our eyes are constantly adapting to those wavelengths of light. How physically we are transformed by the act of looking and seeing colour. So this, as you can see, is an early, quite small painting, part of a series that I made called Fuse Paintings, where I was quite deliberately taking both pre-mixed and self-mixed colour, laying it and rollering it and blending it so that its colour was always in transition. It was always fusing, blending from one colour to another. So a physical mix as well as an optical mix. And this interest in led me to prismatic light, to an interest in prismatic light, which is how, again, the spectrum is formed when light travels through a prism, and we get that famous Richard of York gave battle in vain, which is red, orange, yellow, indigo, green, indigo, violet, whatever it is. But anyway, we get the lovely range of the spectrum. And I was commissioned a long time ago now. It wasn't the first commission I was invited to take part in. That actually was firstly a restaurant called Quaglino's in London, where I painted a column. I was then asked to get involved with the Milton Keynes Theatre, and I made a very large painting which was installed there. But a little after that, I was asked by Ginkgo Projects, which is a quite well-known commissioning body for arts in particularly health, to work with AWW Architects and Bristol Infracare Lift in order to work on a brand new three-story hospital in Bristol. This building actually was built in Germany in sections. So it's like the biggest kind of Meccano building possible, and huge sections of the building designed in Germany were then transported by sea and road and ended up in Bristol. In working with that commissioning body, I was very conscious early on that I wanted to I was first asked to design the exterior panels of the building, but also to propose what I was interested in terms of colour in the building. And I proposed a colour wayfinding scheme. For me, it seemed when I was given the brief that this was a hospital that particularly served a very diverse community, with a lot of people using the hospital for whom English was not their first language. And the democracy of colour, to me, seemed to be apparent, that if we could, from the central central information desk, give people a line to follow through the building, a coloured line to follow through the building to the particular department they needed to visit, that would really operate in a very democratic way. You can see here the central circular desk, and you can see the colours along the floor acting like a prism, you know, giving a sort of prismatic kind of splash across the flooring, which then went along corridors into the lifts up to the next floor. You can see that there's a walkway with the blue and the white across. You can see a little flash of green going to a door on the left image. And so you can see how it operated throughout the building. So this was one of the large fuse paintings. And these, again, were dealing with, towards the end of the series, a real interest in how light could have, how colour has a sort of afterglow. And the optics of it can not only, your eye is not only reading the colour that is there, it's also making optical kind of after colour. So where it might have a sort of purple haze or a pinky haze where actually there is little pink. It's hard for you to perhaps see this on screen. You've got to remember this is a very large painting, and some paintings were even larger than this, optically very affecting. So this was the outside of the same hospital where I was using this sense of gradation of light to dark as it's indicated or suggested light spinning around the building. So it basically went from light to dark, and then dark to light, and then light to dark. And around the different facades of the building, it was a sense of almost as though sun was casting light and shadow all the way around the building. These are the architectural drawings. And though we are covering up most of my image, there is here some of the photographs of the final building. At the same time, because the architects, it was a very complex building, it's not just four-sided, you can see from this image that I think it had about 8 or 10 sides. And the same motif of working from light to dark ran around the whole building. But they had a problem in the front of the building. The orientation changed and the car park was moved. And they really needed to have something to attract visitors to the entrance and to be aware of the entrance. And so I proposed to them a light system which would change throughout the day and night, constantly shifting from one colour to another. So as you can see here, this is a little generated graphic that gives a sense of how the light would very, very slowly change. And as it changed, you might be aware as you walked towards the building, or even as you left the building, that suddenly the light and the colour were different. And so making people aware of shifting colour and changing colour in the same way that, you know, we so often are conscious when we see the sky change, how the colour is changing. So again, sorry that we're covering up the majority of this painting, but at this point, there was a shift in my interest in no longer wanting to use this same process of blending colour, but starting to think about reflecting colour. So the two little panels show you that I was using just reflective pigment and working in a way so that the world was reflected in the surface of the paintings. Quite literally, any of the colour that you see on that painting is simply through the process of photographing it. And in the same way it would change as you stood in front of it, your face was sort of reflected, but not as a face, more as a series of soft gradations of colour. But also, as well as that sort of sense of reflection, I was interested in, you know, the hard edge of colour and how one colour impacts against another colour, as in the very large painting on the right, which also has a reflective surface. Geometry became very important, not geography at this point so much, but geometry more at this point. And looking at a series of ways in which the dynamic in a picture, the energy in a picture, might happen through a very simple division and a very specific combination of colours, so that the colours would activate one another and optically they would impact us. At the same time, I was very conscious, and this you're seeing on a backlit screen, but I was dealing with painting ways that I was desperately trying to kind of not replicate a backlit screen, because I simply wanted that the color in the pictures was so alive because the light was traveling through the particles of paint, bouncing off the white, and literally sort of giving us the same as a backlit scenario, that it would be very transparent, though have a density and an impact through this optical kind of significance of the specific color and how it was made. This is another example. And these examples are here because they introduce, I mean, there were a huge range of ways that the composition was orchestrated in these paintings. I mean, vast. A lot of them were diagonals, a lot of them were unitary, a lot of them were symmetrical, but they all dealt with divisions and tensions and rhythms and repetitions in shape in relation to colour. So this is the Catherine Finch Centre. Mike Scott mentioned about Lindore University, and this was the Performing Arts and Conference Centre that was commissioned there. It actually wasn't a new build, it was refashioned by, I think they were called Day England Stevenson Marsh, and they asked me to help design a curtain wall. You can't see the curtain wall because, as I said, it's again, global events is covering it and Mike Scott's covering it, on my screen at least. But you can see from the bottom left, the architectural drawing incorporating my design for this rhythm of divisions across the windows. And these were etched colour. It wasn't just a film, it was etched into, and it doesn't show it terribly well, but you can just about see that in some of the dark greys, there was again this gradation. So you not only had flat colour, but you had speckled colour and you had gradation of colour. And so, again, sometimes it was opaque, such as the office on the right-hand side, where the practicalities meant that it was useful to have plenty of light, but no distraction of people walking past, and also privacy of that space. Whereas the images to the far left show how a cafeteria area, there was a real value in being able to look out and see the exterior and playing fields beyond. This is another little video that I'll talk to and across. This was a book art work that I made, working with a small team of book producers, artist book producers in Vevey in Switzerland. They were called Deline, and it's actually based on Le Corbusier's sample book colours. He believed that colour could change people's perception of space, and in the 1920s he developed a logically structured system for colour design based on his principles, which he called colour concepts. And he created a colour keyboard for the selection and matching of harmonious colours, mainly for his use within interiors. He assigned specific functions to his colours about weight, depth, perception, unity, the psychological effects of colour. And here, in my own way, I was curious about forming a simple book that could be used to return to certain colours, introduce new colours, look at possibilities of, within a given palette, a palette that obviously I decided upon and orchestrated. And this little booklet was a means to be thinking about and playing with interactions between colours. And as I say, produced actually whilst I was on a sort of peer exchange event in Switzerland, where we looked at book art, looked at the possibilities of book art, but for me it had a practical use in that I was interested in producing something that I could go away and work with in terms of my own paintings, but more specifically perhaps to work with in terms of working in with public buildings and public art projects. I think we've almost come to the end of it, so we'll just let it close and complete. There we go. So here are some of the paintings that were made after the production of that book, or perhaps it was sort of either side, who knows. The interest again was still about the impact of colour, how colour impacts colour, about how looking at something very simple and reductive could hopefully not just work optically, but could work emotively, that certain colours would work to really, really calm your nerve or excite your eye and even impact your heart rate. So this slightly proceeds. This is another project which was called the Orchard Centre in Hull. And this was working with a lot of different artists. I just happened to do the flooring for the main concourse. And you can see my design at the top left. And the fabricators installed flooring on the main image. There was actually a very beautiful desk that I was commissioned to make with Gary Woodley, a fellow artist. A lot of the artists actually involved in this project were, in fact, I think all the artists involved in this project, there were about eight different artists, were all artists working at the Slade UCL. So the desk, unfortunately, was never completed. It was absolutely fabulous, but I think there were issues about more to do with their fear in terms of practicalities rather than any objection to the design. And you can see to some extent, though I'm still pleased with the flooring, my design wasn't quite realised. In part, I don't mind that the colour changed, but the tonality was the key thing for me, that I really wanted a larger tonal range as in my drawing. But again, for the specifics of the requirements, mainly to do with visual impairment and issues of building specification, it was not possible to realise it quite in the way that I'd envisaged. And you know, on all of these projects, one is very aware that that a steering committee, a large group of people, all of whom have to be consulted in order for the final designs to go forward. I mean, that was particularly true of Bristol, the first project I showed you, but many other projects. There is a real energy that in order to convey and convince people of something that they're seeing on a small scale drawing being realized on a large public building and space. So this again, using, I don't think you can see actually the manifestations on the right hand side, those are the things that happen on glass windows to stop you or birds flying or walking into them. And this new build, which was very close to a large roundabout in Wrexham, there were issues here whereby the council became involved relative to a much more highly coloured solution to the exterior of the building, being problematic for those on the island being distracted by the building as they drove past. So, you know, some of the concerns are very different from studio concerns, where you suddenly have, you know, a responsibility to both what people like and are interested in, but also to concerns about what will work for the physical space and what may be problematic in terms of a social aspect of the building. I'm moving you swiftly on, I hope time-wise, okay. This is, these are my two drawing designs for, and I'll move on quickly so you can kind of see what they led to. So this is just to give you a sense of what I would have been producing in order to take forward to the steering groups for this, which is, I'm still awaiting. This is the John Radcliffe Hospital, the Women's Centre, which is in Oxford. And this was completed 2018 to, well, actually it says 19 there, but it actually is much later. It was actually 21, and it was sort of during COVID that this was installed. It just before, you know, COVID, literally like days, and then the hospital stopped any contractors or anybody going in, and then subsequently, you know, there were 2 years where it couldn't be photographed because, again, no one was allowed to go into the hospital unless, you know, it was an emergency. And so I'm awaiting some good documentation of these images. Just so it sort of saves me talking all the way through it, just to give you some sense of what I was aiming for, this is the panel that accompanies it, which talks about the fact this was a, you know, very particular place. It's a glass bridge that was existing. I was having to work with existing architecture, which was rather tired and you know, in need of some major TLC. It was a way that I wanted to, as best I could, enliven and reinvigorate this entrance space to this 70s building. The fact that it was a women's centre where it had the birthing wards and other aspects of women's healthcare related to sort of cancer treatment, and so very, very much, you know, all aspects of very significant aspects of everybody's life, but this is the women's ward or the women's centre. And so I explained, as you can see here, that it was very much that I was conscious of it being this transitory space between the interior and the exterior. And metaphorically, the site can be seen as a bridge between people's spaces, time and experience. And my objective was to celebrate connection from old to new, from incubation to birth and beyond. And I was using these fused bands of fused areas of colour. So again, that sort of intensity of a backlit scenario. One side was very much the fusion of colour. Another side had a lovely sort of rhythmic configuration of a grid. In part, for me, this came out of having been so, having experienced Matisse's chapel in Vence and the black and white wall drawings and the colour window, which reflects light onto the black and white wall drawings had really sort of had a huge impact on me when I saw it, to see light and colour having such impact in relation to graphic. And so though I couldn't replicate something like that, it is very much that the intense colour has the potential to be seen through the graphic grid, and also at certain days, at times of day, to be cast one against the other. This is just a little bit, because, you know, in talking about private and public, there are many times that my paintings have ended up both in other spaces other than exhibitions, in hotel foyers and large public spaces, Milton Keynes Theatre being one, sometimes specifically designed for the space, as in Milton Keynes, where I worked on two large curved panels which went around the drum wall of the auditorium, or simply large paintings that were bought in order to work in a particular space. Or, as in this instance, working, Peggy Prendeville, an interior designer in London, contacted me for a commission where she was completely redesigning the interior of someone's home, and asked me to come and talk to the client and to make a painting specifically for the space. At the top left, you can see the actual painting and a small study. And then you can see from the two other images, the work in situ. I'm just conscious of time. So as Mike mentioned at the beginning of this, in the introduction to the talk, in 2019, myself and others set up the Brighton Storeroom, and with the generous assistance and help of Michael and Alison Pyle, who run a farmer's market there in the centre, in St George Valley, in the centre of Barbados. Beautiful old foaling stable, which they kindly restored and made into a gallery space. These are just some of the pictures showing it. The idea behind this space was that very much, you know, there was a real need. There are so many interesting artists there. There was a real need for a space to show contemporary artists' work. And we had long been involved in and interested in curating exhibitions and showing artwork. And so in essence, again, we were struck by COVID somewhat, and the intention to work across the region was slightly curtailed, but it did mean that we were able to focus on the artists within Barbados, but also those who were Belgian but living and working abroad. We put on many exhibitions. I'm going to show you my exhibition. I did try for a long time to resist having a show there. It's such a beautiful space. I really wanted to show there, but I was conscious that our ambition was always to show work of local, regional, and artists from the diaspora, and not anyone else. But having been so involved for so long, eventually I did succumb and showed a series of paintings that I'd made whilst I was there. And I was very conscious that the paintings that I made there had been influenced by, you know, I've lived in the UK and travelled to Barbados for many years, perhaps 35 plus years. During the pandemic, I was there for 2 years, almost, you know, nonstop, unable to travel elsewhere, no need to travel anywhere else. And the aspects of light and colour that perhaps had, you know, slowly had impact upon me became more intensified, and likewise an interest in nature, in skies. The picture on the left is called Green Flash, which you probably know is, you know, the term for as the sun sets, the potential for a green flash to appear in the sky. I didn't set out to make a sunset or sunrise painting, or, you know, or even for it to be a naturalistic kind of depiction. But I suppose it's undeniable to a degree that there is an association there. On the right hand side, just for interest, we were, whilst I was living there, struck by the fact that there was a volcanic eruption on a neighbouring island, and the volcanic dust was carried into the air across and dropped basically on Barbados. And so we were covered and dramatically sort of again unable to use the airport, or, you know, and many people were severely impacted by it. To live through it was the strangest experience, you know, to feel, you know, the light of the sun and the moon almost sort of obliterated, and to see this sort of cloud of heavy dust. I remember waking up early and just couldn't believe everything was coated in dust, but also the air was just full of volcanic dust. And so how strange that was. And in fact, I gathered up some of the dust. We had to gather up the dust in order to stop it impacting, you know, drainage and all sorts of things, and simply to clean and clear everywhere. And then I decided to use it to paint with. And so it was included. These are just simply images of Barbados and the impact of nature coming in and probably influencing some of the subsequent paintings that I've made. I'm not going to read this because there isn't time, but I can always go back to it. It's a poem that I actually wrote, but it's a poem where I simply wanted to use quotes from other painters. So every line is actually the line of another artist, and usually another painter, who said something about colour. And so it's constructed in that sort of way, that I've changed nothing other than the order that, you know, rather the words have been accumulated from others, and the order has been changed in order for me to express something that also, you know, I want to say about colour through them. So I started to make a lot of fabric collages. Paint is difficult to acquire in Barbados. It's expensive. And at the same time, I'd been collaging for a long time. I was interested in materials. I've always been interested in materials. And there are many, I haven't given you many examples. There are some much more complex and large and referred collages that I'm still working on. This was equally beginning to try and work with the dust in itself as a material. And this I just thought was quite interesting perhaps for you to see. There's a very short video of me on the east coast of Barbados, which is very different from the west coast, collecting essentially, this is where the Atlantic hits the shore, and all of the plastic and sea rubbish gets cast up on the beach, which I've been collecting and using both to make works with plastic, but also to look at colour once colour has been, man-made colour has been impacted by nature and by duration within the sea. And that is the East Coast there, just something of the seaweed. I've got quite a bit of a desire to actually try and grind the seaweed and see whether I can actually use that as a painting material as well. I am now going to stop sharing my screen. And hopefully everyone else will join me again.
Oh, that was really wonderful. And I love the poem at the end. I've actually been writing some ekphrastic poetry. So I was taking all kinds of notes and thinking about doing a similar things, sort of a found poem. And then I was fascinated by the fact that you brought up the poem as a, you know, found poem, and then immediately turned to the idea of these found objects in Barbados, and also just to, you know, to, well, the found dust, the found plastic. Yeah, so that was that a, I guess my question, if I have one here, is how that sort of metaphor of what's found has played out throughout your career, right? When you look back, do you see that as a factor early on as well as later?
Well, I suppose, you know, I very much paint in the sense that I do not have a pre-prescribed notion of what the painting will be like at the very end. So you could, you know, argue that I find the image as I go along. So with the fuse paintings, I would lay out color and I would then transfer that color. But often the color and the palette might change. And so the rhythms might change. And so those rhythms would be solved through, you know, a selection of one thing and modification. As a process, it's pretty much unique. Nobody I know of, you know, a lot of people felt when they first saw them, perhaps they might be spray painted, or they're actually made with domestic rollers. And, you know, I sort of perfected a way of making that was, for me, to do with finding a way to add the material to the surface. And so, you know, finding a solution was key in that sense. With the geometry, how to find a balance, how to find a rhythm, how to find something that I felt optically was engaging, interesting, and held my attention, was about finding solutions. It wasn't using particularly, you know, known routes to do that. So as a, you know, as someone always curious, always looking at the world, looking at paintings, looking at how the natural world, how artificial light, how, you know, evening light affects something. How I had a lovely quote, which I also didn't include, which I don't know whether I can find for you, which is, no, I can't. Which is about the fact that, you know, within a shadow, how do you name the color in a shadow? It's those sort of edges of things that are hard to, you know, to define. So found, I certainly was never very good at going to another artist and taking very directly from them. But I think I was always looking, whether it was within art or within, you know, the general looking of life and seeing and observing, I was always seeking out things. So I don't know whether that's found. I am conscious that, you know, the island itself asked me to sort of look at different materials. But as I said, I was making collages, paper collages often before. And the little collages, sometimes we're using fabric, sometimes we're using found images. They were ways to, again, kind of not recycle, but a little bit of me recycling. You know, a lot of the fabrics that I use aren't bought. They're, you know, I'm someone who likes making, you know, cushions, or I used to make clothing. And so there's, you know, there's a recycling going on in the thinking, as well as the sort of quite literally the practicality of reusing a fabric. Wow. As well as, you know, those found fabrics in the world, as, you know, I touched on at the very end, which is, you know, those are very early days. I don't really, you know, I haven't really shown you any of the things that I've made with the plastics. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I've only got the ambition to make something with the seaweed.
Wow. Well, I can't wait to see that. Joe, do you
Yeah, I was just, you hear the term upcycling, where you're taking sort of found junk, if you will, and turning it into and up, bringing it up to some level of art. And it put me in mind, well, I have a few thoughts. One of them, you talk about what are the colors of things in the shadows. And I took a screenshot of your poem because I was like, I have to revisit this. And one of the lines in the last stanza was, all colors will agree in the dark, which I found interesting and provocative. So I thank you for that. But last week we had a presentation.
A lot of painters really like to look. And this is, traditionally, this is, something that is very established, that like to look at their paintings at a particular sort of evening hour, because optically how you then read and see the color relationships as much as anything is much, much more conducive at that time of day. So it is something. I'm just conscious that as we say this about shadows, light is almost disappeared from my room. I'm just going to open if you don't mind.
I thought you were teaching us a lesson even in the presentation.
In the dark, just one sec.
Okay.
Not a commentary.
That's right, yes.
Oh, there we go.
Ah, look at that. Oh. Yeah, one of the questions I had, Estelle, it had to do with your...
Some very lovely light.
Oh, yes. Very nice.
Oh, wow.
Okay, sorry about
that. You had mentioned was that the painting was called Volcanic Ash. Was that the one? The title?
Well, it was called Dust to Dust.
Dust to Dust.
Yeah.
One of the things. Yeah. Last week we had a presentation by someone from Georgetown University, Nathan Hensley, in the English department. And he talked about J.M.W. Turner and Claude Monet, sort of, those foggy, hoary, faint images in the background, how beautiful they look. But part of that was a result of smog. And so sort of taking in what has happened in the natural environment and recreating that, and that becoming sort of a focus of art in and of itself. And so I was struck by your presentation in the Dust and Ash, how that became what is seen and what becomes the subject of our attention, not just the thing that needs to be kind of cut through. So
actually in 19, I I've touched on my paintings in the most kind of incidental kind of way, really, to make the whole talk. But in 1987 or 8, I made a painting that is still important to me. It's a very small grey painting, which wasn't called Dust to Dust. It was called Ashes to Ashes. Mm-hmm. And it was an ash grey kind of scenario. I think at the time I really wanted to make something that, talked about this cycle of life, from birth to life to death. A lot of the early paintings did touch on more natural forms that, could almost be read as twig-like forms or sticks, and I made some very early paintings which had vapors of sort of mists and also standing stones and rocks, and had a real sort of sense of nature and earth and the fundamental aspects of those sort of things like mists and clouds and things that are in transition, that aren't fixed, alongside the fixed elements of and they weren't really twigs. I don't really know what they were, but they were elements that conveyed something of nature.
Mm-hmm.
And so in that, I do feel a little bit like, not that I'm gone full circle, but there is something whereby of the phenomenon of material shifts move towards light and color a great deal. But those all encompass. I've written something actually recently, a very short piece for a symposium on color and poetry that the Slade runs annually, which is about my interest in rainbows, and that the time in Barbados has afforded me, because of it being a small island, it has a large number of rainbows. They're almost daily. Sometimes double ones, I think I've certainly seen a double. Have I seen a triple? I'm not sure. But, you're very conscious of them when you're in the sea when you're walking around, you're, you know, there's a lot of light rain. It's a small island. It's sunny. And so rainbows occur. And that led me to look at and think about the fact that a lot of paintings, actually, and a lot of painters historically have been very interested in depicting rainbows. And I don't think it's just, you know, it's in part because obviously it's a very fascinating thing that we all, you know, it's magical for all of us to see a rainbow. But that sort of phenomenon of a natural event where light and colour is so, you know, inspiring and wonderful.
Yeah, I just wondered if you could talk a little bit more about how your physical environment does or doesn't change what you're doing, because I, you know, London versus Barbados is huge, right? And I was thinking, are you able to bring Barbados to London, or are you, do you bring London to, so maybe you could just talk about that a little bit.
Yeah, well, I do have studios in both, and the experience of, so the image when I was showing you, actually had a Cicero quote that you probably saw there, which wasn't made by me. It was actually made by Dennis, who also has a studio there. And as you look out of the studio space that we have, you look to a garden, and there are steps into the garden, and the sort of lettering cast into the concrete basically translates, I'm not going to try to say the Latin, but it translates to say, if you have a garden in a library, nothing is missing. And it was written to talk about this, the alternation between culture and cultivation, you know, the notion that an academic might, when it was written by Cicero, the notion that if you, from your library, from your study where you were contemplating the world, if you could see a garden, if you could experience a garden, you had everything, you know, you were complete, nothing was missing. Life was complete by these two things coming together. And, you know, I am very conscious that if I take a break from the studio in Barbados, and even just day-to-day living, the rhythm of my day is completely different. You know, I wake up in Barbados and it's pitch black. You know, I wouldn't normally wake up here and it'd be so dark. So I often will wake up and it's pitch black. You know, it really is dark. I go to bed early and I wake early. It's the nature of a hot climate. And then at the same time, night falls very quickly. So, you know, you're very conscious that at one moment it's very bright and light, and another moment the sun has set and it's dark. Going to the sea daily, I swim daily. And so I'm submerged in water. I'm aware of the changing skies. I'm aware of the weather and nature. I'm aware of, you know, it's very, very, very verdant. And so, you know, the growth of plants is enormous. I've cultivated a little garden for myself with pots as well as the garden. So lots of bromeliads and, you know, plants that do well within pots. And I'm very conscious of suddenly looking at, you know, nature more readily and being immersed in nature more readily than the London studio. The London studio, you know, I am absolutely immersed in, you know, the centre of London, you know, busy, bustling, concrete world that you get glimpses on nature, but it's a very, very different experience. You're not so aware of changing skies, and the pace of life is different too. The pace with which you contemplate things, the pace with which you engage with making is different. I do feel that I enjoy that. I brought back some paintings with me, small ones, from Barbados that I'd started there. And to be perfectly honest, though the little colour ones that I showed you four of, that were sort of the gradations, there are about 60 or so of those now, and I'm happily reworking those, and I don't feel it's problematic in any way. There are another series of paintings that are similar to the one with the ash, which I found very, very difficult to work on here. I just don't seem to be able to connect into the making of those in this city. So yeah, it's curious. I haven't worked out yet whether it's what that reason is, but
Thank you for that. I could, obviously we could go on an hour or more because I'm just fascinated by this. But I think Mike needs to weigh in with some final comments, and we need to close up in about 4 minutes. So,
okay. Estelle, thank you. Thank you, Catherine. Thank you, Joe, for the conversation. I heard it was a beautiful discussion today, a beautiful presentation. I was particularly moved by the work you do in the hospitals and the colours in the hospitals, how you're changing that, how colour is life because it's light, light of life. Personally, I know the Radcliffe very well here in Oxford, and I've had a very sad time there. The fact that you now put colour there, because it was always so drab all the time.
It was quite a challenge, I can tell you. That building, like, freaked me out, and they told me that.
It was just an awful building.
I was going to work with, but in fact, actually, you know, once we get, I was mentioning to you earlier, Mike, you know, often I haven't seen the final works installed. Time just takes over, and I've never seen Hull. I've never been to South Bristol to see it in the flesh. John Radcliffe, because of COVID, I couldn't, but I plan to go there very, very soon. But I really, really hope I can get some images that do it justice. Because from Ruth the other day, who was the commissioning agent, and she said she sees it because she lives in Oxford, and she said it really gives her a big buzz every time she sees it. And it's, you know, it's really...
Oh, that's the point. The point is that people see it. The people who are going into the hospital see it. The people that come out of the hospital, the visitors see it.
Yeah.
And it gives a sense of peace, and it gives a sense of continuity as well with life. And I think this is very, very important work. And I can say that from a personal experience. Anyway, thank you, Estelle. Thank you, everybody else. Bye. And our next event in this series is on Tuesday, the 14th of February, St. Valentine's Day, when Graham Oppenheimer, the international viola player, founder of the Shidlof Quartet, quite famous, he's going to talk about his instrument, and he's going to, as an instrument formed from nature, and he's also going to, he tells me, play a few things as well. I'm really looking forward to that. So this is a first in any of the series that we'll have somebody actually playing an instrument. I think that's the case, Catherine. I'm not quite sure looking at you, but I think it is. Anyway, so Graham will be with us next week. On the 15th of February, there's a Zoom, which you might like to know. It's a free speech project at the Crossroads International Dialogues event, in association with the Future Humanities Project, where a panel will be discussing democracy entangled. And in particular on that day, they'll be discussing Brazil. And then a little bit later, the following month, they'll be discussing Israel. And a bit later on, they'll be discussing Iran. So it's not always going to be the same panel, but it's going to be the discussion. I think that those are really important areas in the world at the moment with problems, and it'd be a great discussion. So that's on the 15th of February. But today I'd like to thank those at Georgetown University who've made all these events happen, especially our administrators, Julia Murillo and Mary Gordon. Of course, Jack DeJoy, the president, and Tom Banchoff, the vice president of global affairs, at Campion Hall, to Nick Austin, and Ying Ying, our administrator there. At Blackfriars, to Richard Finn, the director of the Las Casas Institute, and John O'Connor, the regent. My thanks as ever to Maggie, who's helped do the administrations for this. My thanks to also to Catherine, to Joe, to Mike Collins, who have been putting this all together. So don't forget, please, to join us for our next free speech session, Wednesday, the 15th of February, 11 a.m. EST, 4 p.m. in the UK. And next Tuesday, 14th of February, for a Bent But Beautiful World event on Brazil, event with Graham Oppenheimer. In the meantime, keep safe. Thank you again, Estelle. Thank you, everybody. I'm Mike Scott. Please follow me on Twitter at Mike Scott Prof. Thank you and goodbye.